Good morning, everyone. I just want to remind us this morning that it should be a very exciting time for all of us. We should all be celebrating, and I mean that just not with a little smile, but with a big smile, as it says in Luke chapter 15, verse 10. It says that the heaven is celebrating over the one, and we have one, and we have another one. We have two. So the heavens are celebrating, and so we also need to be celebrating. But not only that, it says in 3 John that the Lord is glorified. He's happy over the fact that he hears of his people walking in him. So we see right here now those that are starting the walk as they are going to be baptized in just a few minutes. First thing I want to do is remind you of the things. I don't think it's on the sheet, but we have church council tomorrow night. So if you all be... those that are part of that, make sure that you're there for that. Wednesday, also, we have Bible study at 6:30, but we're meeting out here in front of the church, right here on this corner, at 6:20. Out there at 6:20, not here at the church, but out there at 6:20, so we can be back into the Bible study by 6:30. So remember that. Well, I want to welcome the visitors. Also, those who are in the parking lot, those online, we welcome you all in this celebration. And we hope that today's service is a blessing to each one of you, okay? Robin has... When she was in care during a specific part of her life, I talked to Robin and she was excited in the fact that the Lord knew that the Lord gave her, he had patience in her, just like he does with a lot of us. And at the moment when she felt the calling of the Holy Spirit on her, she decided it was time for her to receive Jesus, and she professed him in the rehab center, which was so awesome. And she is so excited, she's so vibrant, and she wants to be serving in the church. She's looking forward to singing in the choir. What a blessing it is to see the excitement. And that's the excitement that each one of us needs to conjure up and remember what it was like when we received Jesus and be excited. Robin, do you... Have you professed Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
Good, good. Do you promise to obey and serve him for the rest of your life?
Yes, I do.
Robin, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, yes, raised in the likeness of his resurrection to walk in newness of life. What a relationship that Brother Joe and I've had through the process. I felt like I've known him for a couple of years, when actually it's been, what, 4 months?
Yes.
About 3 months, something like that. So it's been exciting to get to know Brother Joe, and it's exciting also that he has seen the changes in his wife. And Joe this morning comes in baptism because he too professed Jesus as his Lord and Savior. What an exciting thing to happen. I love it. Brother Joe, do you profess Jesus as
yes.
your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you promise to obey and serve him for the rest of your life?
Yes, I do.
Oh, man, that's awesome. All right, Brother Joe, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in newness of life. To walk I think Miss Ann is going to do the invocation prayer. Okay? Thank you.
Feeling? Yes. Yeah. We welcome each and every one of you this morning, our people at home, those in the parking lots, our visitors. We are so very, very glad to have you this morning. Our praise song this morning, we're going to have that, and then we'll have our invocation, but our praise song is "He Has Made Me Glad," and this is a song of Thanksgiving, but you know what? Why does Thanksgiving come only once a year? In our hearts, people, it should be every day. Does anybody agree with me? Yes, yes, indeed. I tell you what, I don't know about you, but I've got a lot to be thankful for, and I think everybody here has, and we are so blessed to have a church to come to, the freedom to worship our God and Lord and to sing His praises. Stand as you are able. He has made me glad. To start our worship service today with a beautiful baptism and a beautiful song. And my goodness gracious, are y'all in good voice today? I do declare. Y'all been holding back some here now. We're going to go to the Lord now in prayer. Let's bow our heads. Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for being our Lord and our Savior. And Lord, for being such a good shepherd to us, sometimes we have a tendency to want to stray, but you're always there to pull us back, to help us, to love us, to forgive us. Dear Heavenly Father, we do have a day of thanksgiving every day in our lives. So much to be thankful for. We ask, Lord, that you have a special blessing on those who could not be with us here today, those who are at home not feeling well, those who are traveling, Lord, just give them safe traveling mercies. Dear God, we ask now that you open our hearts and our minds to your teaching. Help each of us, Lord, to turn our lives over to you, to help us to be better Christians, stronger Christians, and to reach out to others. We ask, Lord, now that you be with us as we continue in our worship service. And we thank you so much, God, for being our Lord and Savior. These things we ask in thy name. Amen. Casey will be right out. I promise. Holy, holy, holy. Let's stand as you are able.
In our glorious service to the Lord, let's now prepare our hearts for giving. Please be seated. Thank you. Oops, I'm sorry, miss. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are especially thankful, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. Lord, as the Holy Spirit draws those to him, it's such an exciting time, Lord. And I praise you, Lord, for that. And Lord, this morning as we give of ourselves, we give now in our tithes and offerings, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, to take this, Lord, and apply it to your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Thank you all for that. That's praising and music. One of the ways we talked about in Bible study, one of the postures, one of the ways that we can worship is what we show in our singing. And one of the ways we don't, which I invite you to do, is the raising of the hand and saying amen. That's a start, right? One day, maybe we might even stand up. How about that? Well, man, wouldn't that be good today? No pressure or anything, but wouldn't that be nice? This morning, the display of baptism or the obedience of baptism displays a love for Christ. It's one of the things that we do because Christ commanded us to do it. There are many other things that Christ commands us to do. We do not take them literally sometimes. We just look at it as just words that are said in our scriptures, but they are very important, and that's what we're going to talk about this morning. One of the things we touched on in Bible study is how powerful the word love is and how loosely we use the word. We use the word as if it's a, I love my turtle. Well, I don't have a turtle, but I have a lot of dogs to love. But love, what does love mean? Uh-oh. So we're going to talk about this morning. When Jesus was asked about the most important commandment, he made a very simple, he made it, I mean, just so simple for us, just straight out, you would think it is, when he said in Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." Wow, 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 wow. And then it goes on, the second is this: "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." The love of Jesus is so powerful. It's so hard for us to grasp. It is something that we should try, that we should make an intentional effort to attain, right? Don't you agree with that? Should we not try to attain that type of love, right, in our movement? But he did make it simple by breaking down the whole law into two to-dos. Into two to-dos. Can't say that fast 10 times, can we? But we can practice. But just because something is simple, we know it's not easy because we've experienced it, right? We've experienced the effort in trying. And the words that we say a lot of times to cover our ineptness is that we're just sinners and we're human and we just can't. A lot of times because of that, we don't try. We really don't make the effort because we can't do it anyway, right? For a lot of people, things that they can't do, they don't even make an effort to do them because of that. But the love that he's talking about here is something that we need to be thinking about this morning as we move forward as a church family. We need to be understanding what he means by these things, by how we should love him, how we should love each other. But the looseness, the way we use love, doesn't really have a lot of meaning to it. Today, as we see through the generations, we see love for the most part as not much more than infatuation, right? It's something that's, it just goes by, you know. It might be something that was good at the time, and then it just kind of went away. But the love that we're talking about here is wholesome. So on the contrary, the word love is so deep. It's so deep and has so much meaning. So to understand these commands is to understand what God's love means. These two commandments, as I said, are not easy. And as a matter of fact, without Christ, it's impossible to live by. So we need to understand, and after we understand what we're talking about today, we need to be able to we need to pray, we need to say, "Lord, I need you," in order to do the very thing that I understand now from our scriptures, that I understand from what you're telling me. So this morning, that's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about loving him. This record of Jesus speaking, talking about loving him, is the well-known Shema. And if you look at Deuteronomy 6, chapter 6, verses 4 through 5, who has their Bible this morning? I mentioned I was going to do that this morning. Hold your Bible up. Look, I know there's a lot of electronics out there. Well, praise God. I think I saw electronics somewhere. No. But we need this. We need this Bible. Let me tell you one of the reasons why. Isn't it nice if you know Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians? Wouldn't it be nice to know so that when somebody asks you or tells you to turn to something, you can actually find it? That would be one reason, right? or to go in your Old Testament and start with Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and just start memorizing your order so that way you can go in and find exactly what you need. Sometimes electronics makes things, yes, simple and easy, but we need to start with the basics. We need to actually have our Bibles with us. I remember the movie that I watched. What was it? Is it Denzel Washington? About the Bible becoming extinct in the apocalypse, I think it was, and he was carrying the last Bible. But the thing that was unique about it, when he lost that Bible because everybody was after it, he had it right here. And he carried that to the destination. He carried the Bible with him to the destination. I think about that with us today. Are you wanting to carry the scriptures with you to your destination? I know I do. All right, so we know the Shema. Let's read that. 5 and 6. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Well, that was 5. Do we have Deuteronomy 6:4 and 5? I can still read that. I want to go. It's the same, basically the same thing, but let's go to it real quick, if you would. It is, hear, O Israel. Okay? Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. Then it goes on to say in verse 5, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. In 6 it says, these words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. I'm going to go a little further. You shall teach them diligently to your sons, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and then you shall be, then they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on the gates. That's how important it is to understand these commands. So that's what we're going to look at in Matthew and in Luke. This is about loving the Lord with all your heart. Jesus doesn't just say that our lives, he's not just telling us or trying to convince us that our lives will be better if we do this. He doesn't promise happiness. He doesn't say that these are nice ideas. He says that you shall love the Lord my God with all my heart. In other words, as if it is essential to really living my life, living your life. In other words, as the KJV, King James Version says, the dictionary, KJV dictionary says, about shall. What does the word shall mean? If we study the scriptures here, we'll see the shall is in the second and third persons, it implies a promise, a command, or a determination. So it is not something just like we talked about the greats. Commission is not the great suggestion, right? Here, this is not a suggestion. This is a command. It is vital to really experiencing the full and abundant life. After all, you will make known to me, as it says in Psalm 16:11. Did I give that to you? Psalm 16:11. If you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Psalm 16:11. I might not have given it to her, so that's my fault. 16:11. It says, for you will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand, there are pleasures forever. So walking in the love, walking in the Lord, that's what we can see will happen. So by loving him with all your heart, you place yourself in the position of joy. Joy that is there regardless of your current circumstances. Whatever it is that you're going through in your life, sometimes we feel alone. We feel like we're the only ones that are going through something. But we're not. All of us is going through something. And to others, it may be the worst thing. But as my father used to remind me many times over, there's always someone that's going through something worse than you are. I don't know about you, but I want that kind of full joy in my life. Don't you? Don't you all want that? And with all your heart is just only the beginning. That's just only beginning what he's saying here. I must also love him with all my soul, my mind, and my strength. And like I said before, this may be simple, but it's not easy as the word love in God's being is just so deep. So let's look at what it means, the context of loving the Lord with all your heart. In Mark and Matthew, Mark 12 and Matthew 22, Jesus was recorded as having said these same words, as well as Luke 10. And what he's doing here is he's basically citing the Shema. But here is the context for why Jesus tells us these words in Matthew 22 and Mark 12. At this point in time in these verses, Jesus has resurrected Lazarus from the dead. He has entered Jerusalem with a triumphal entry on a colt, fulfilling prophecies. He has entered the temple and he's driven out all those who were buying and selling goods there. He has healed the blind and lame at the temple, who came to all those that came to him. And this next day of Holy Week, Tuesday, he has returned to the temple to teach. Both the Pharisees and Sadducees are there. Uh-oh, here we go. Now, we can see a lot of Pharisees and Sadducees among us, can't we? And I'm talking about right here in the pew. I'm talking about in our lives, right? We see a lot of Pharisees and Sadducees. These are groups of Jewish leaders. They were trying to trap Jesus in his teachings by asking him what they thought were actually trick questions. Both groups thought of Jesus as a public nuisance who was getting in the way of their political and religious goals. How about that? Those goals that have nothing to do with God's word. Isn't that a lot like people in the church today who have agendas or self-serving ideas where God is not to get the glory? We see that in a lot of churches. Here, if they, the Sadducees and Pharisees, could get him to say something heretical, then they might be able to kind of sway the current public opinion during that time. First, the Pharisees sent a group of their disciples and some Herodians to ask Jesus about the imperial tax to Caesar. You know the story, some of you may not. But Jesus was not deterred and called them out on their evil intent. Then that same day, the Sadducees, the group of Jewish believers who did not believe in the bodily resurrection, came to ask him about marriage and the resurrected life. The example they gave was a woman who was married 7 times. Namely, whose wife she would be in the resurrection. But Jesus tells them they are in error. They are in error. And that they do not know the scriptures, nor the power of God. He also tells them that the earthly marriage will not be part of the resurrection. Basically amazed like the first group, they also leave. Finally, the Pharisees try again by getting an expert in the law to ask Jesus, which commandment is the greatest? Which commandment? For if Jesus chose any of the commandments above the others, they knew that they could trap him. But he responded in Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9, for which they have been very familiar with. He said, "Hear, O Israel, hear, Israel. The Lord is our God. The Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. And you shall repeat them diligently to your sons and speak of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk on the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. You shall also tie them as a sign to your hand, that they shall be as frontlets on your forehead. You shall also write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The importance here we see of loving your God with everything you have. This word, this here Israel, this beginning here is the became a very important prayer. This became their daily prayer. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. You know, how can that be? How can it be the foremost? There is so much in the scriptures. There's so much that God requires of us. There's so much, and that explains why love is such a huge word. That's why it's so important to understand the love and all the adjectives that, not an English major here, but all the things that describe love will cover every aspect of your life. See, love, just to give you a few of them, is the patience that God has had with me. I think about that a lot. My goodness, tragedy could have struck me over and over in my life. I'm reminded of my son at 16 years of age. That could have been me. It could have been any one of you. But the Lord has chose to be patient enough with me to allow me to see the error of my ways and to actually sit still long enough to hear him, to listen, and to be obedient. What a loving God, a forgiving God. As I'm able to take everything in my life and wrap it up into a bundle and give it to him, where many of us will say, I have done so much wrong. There is no way that this God will forgive me. It's too late. But see, that's not the way our God is. He cast our sins as far as it is from the, as far as the east is from the west. It's forever gone. And we are able from that point on not to live in a perfect life, but to live in an intentional life, making mistakes, but having a Father that we can go through. We can go through Jesus and say, Jesus, I know that I disappointed you. And Lord, I'm repenting now of my mistakes, of my sin, Lord. I love him, and that's why I do it. There's many more adjectives, many more things that we can describe as love. You know, let's look at Luke chapter 10, verse 27. And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. Again, many times over, the same thing. How do we love God? You heard in Deuteronomy what we are supposed to do with these words, how we are supposed to remember them, how we're supposed to teach them, how we're supposed to put it on our forehead. Remember how we are to acting accordingly. Next thing, how do we love God with all of our heart? It means to love God with your emotions. Praising him with your happiness, your smile, and gratitude. But of course, that's easy, isn't it, when things are going well? I was reminding everyone earlier that we needed to be really excited this morning for the baptism. Because we know in Luke 15, I believe it is 10, where it says that heaven is celebrating. Why are we not celebrating? Why are we not exciting? We are an extension of heaven. We are waiting to have our day in heaven with Jesus. So therefore, we are celebrating with them as the one comes to the Lord. Because why? Because we love the Lord. But you know, as I was saying earlier, when things are going well, sometimes it's easy to forget about God. I don't need him. I've got everything under control. But how about when things aren't going so well? You know, many prayers go like this. Lord, I've taken control of my life, and I've seen it go to ruin. But see, if you remember, before you said it's going to ruin, everything was nice. So, great possibility, super great possibility, that before you got to that point, that if we were in prayer, if we were in fellowship with God, we might not have had to experience what we were getting ready to experience and praying for. See, I'm one of those that doesn't like to, you know, think wish to shoulda coulda. I like to handle my business ahead of time. I like to be thinking I am setting myself on a bad course, and that course is without the Lord. So before I make that turn, I might have gone off on the side of the road a little bit to make that left-hand turn, but I had just enough room to pull back over on that straight and narrow. I know some of you know what I'm talking about when you accidentally, you almost took the wrong exit, right? It's how it is in our life sometimes. We want to take control of our life, so we go to take that exit, and then you realize, whoa, 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 and you try to hurry up, and you look in your mirror to see if you can get back on the highway. That's how we are in life, and it's okay. Did you know that's okay? Because you know what? The conviction of the Holy Spirit is alive. And if it's not alive in you, we need to be thinking, do I know Jesus? The Holy Spirit is there. He is speaking to you. He is sharing with you. He is illuminating things for you. He's teaching you. But all too often, we are going, trying to take things over and go in our own directions. But you know what? Even when God seems quiet, he's not really that quiet. It's our lives are noisy. I was watching a show last night, and it was a guy being interrogated, and he started screaming. Nobody could hear him. You know why? Because the guy went over there and turned up the stereo real loud. See, he made sure it was really noisy, so nobody could hear him. But see, that's a lot like our lives today. Our lives are noisy because they're so busy and we're making so many decisions, and sometimes those decisions are made on a whim. I'm speaking about even myself. And then we correct it because we feel the Holy Spirit pulling on our heart. So we shall continue to love God even when bad things happen or when good things don't happen. So it's easy to say when things aren't happening the way we want to that God is not existent. He's forgotten you. He's left you to do your own thing. But you know what? I've reminded people before, even myself, that sometimes we find ourselves in a spot in our life and then we start challenging God. And when we start challenging God, then we start doing things as a result of sort of slipping away a little bit. God, I'm trying it your way. It's not working. This is what's happening as a result of it. Breaking off the fellowship with God, and then things start to spiral. And then you say, but I'm praying. The problem is, I know when I'm fussing with my mom, I know they're not listening. They're not listening like I want to them to listen. I think of it a lot like our Father, that when we do things the way we want to and we fuss and gripe and get out of fellowship with him, that he's turned his head and he says, go for it. Do your thing. Let me know how it's working for you, and I'll see you back in a little bit. Because that's how it is, isn't it? We end up back. If you love God, you will be back. So loving God all the time is a day in, day out learning process. Constant, 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 constant. You will never be there. You will be constantly working on it. And I shared the word to you. The magic word that's not really magic is being intentional. Making an effort. Intentional, I haven't even looked it up, but my definition of intentional means the absence of excuse. Because we have tons of excuses why we can't do things and why we don't do things. But the Lord really knows why. There's a problem with our relationship. So we learn more and more as we stay day in and day out in a fellowship with God, and we continue to trust him, continue to listen to him, continue to love him, until soon you can say and believe just like the Apostle Paul. Love his example as he says, follow me because I follow him. And he says, I am content no matter what the circumstances. I can live on almost nothing. Let's look at Philippians chapter 4, 11 through 13. Not that I speak from want, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, and I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering need. The words from Apostle Paul is the words that we can should be able to identify with. So we know the secret of living in every situation is remembering that I can do everything. I can live through anything. I can even overcome. How? Through Christ, who gives us strength. He gives us sustenance, and he gives us courage. And if you look at the word courage, I don't know if you know this, but if you look at the word courage, in the it's Latin for heart. So living with courage and heart daily is a good way to remind yourself to love God. So how do we love him with all of our soul? It's a lot, isn't it? It's deep. To love God with your soul means that the natural part of you that always knew that you were brought into existence by a creator. Many people say, I know there's a higher being. Well, I hate to tell everyone that's not enough. That's not enough. When you look at all the intricacies of the universe, the planet, and your own body, a piece of you really knows. Yes, you figure out that you have a God-shaped hole within you that can only be satisfied by him, by Jesus. But then you have to allow yourself to go even further past that simple knowing and let yourself believe that God not only exists, are you hearing me? Not only exists, but he loves you enough to send his only begotten son to die and free you from your sins. What a love, love that we just can't understand. Not only died for those that were within his presence, but died for us that he knew that he had a plan for. That he knew we're going to do what we did for me for many, many, many years. For you for however many years. He died for you. See, your soul takes you much further than your heart can. It takes you to a solid relationship with the living Lord. And as a bonus, heaven. As a bonus, heaven. I love what Spurgeon, with the Spurgeon Study Bible says, with all your heart means intensely. With all your soul means sincerely, most lovingly. And with all your strength means with all our energy, with every faculty, with every possibility of our nature, of who we are. That's a lot, isn't it? More ways to understand love. And then we got the mind. How do we love him with our mind? Trusting him with your heart, you continue to the next area. Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. My goodness sakes alive. That scripture alone should speak to many of us, as sometimes we jump the gun, don't we? We take credit for a lot that goes on in our lives, and we want credit for some reason, evidently. But we are not called as someone who has died to self, as we saw in baptism, okay? Buried in the likeness of his death. When we are buried in the likeness of his death, who we were is gone. So now We are raised in the likeness of his resurrection. But that's not the end of it, because now we are walking in newness of life. So it's no longer in your own understanding, but in God's understanding, what he desires for our life, in order for him to have his will in this troubled world. I was talking to a neighbor last night, and it was funny. We were talking about how bad the world is, and I said, yes, fathers, husbands, the men in this world will not stand up and be who God wants us to be in the spiritual leaders, as spiritual leaders in the family and in the churches. And then the fellow that I'm not going to mention, because a lot of you I found out later know, he says, yeah, and the women, and she spoke up and said, I knew that was coming. I just knew it was coming. I knew it was coming. But we have a love for Christ that needs to be in action. It needs to be who, not only what we do, but who we are. Because God is love, we are called to emulate him, so we are to be striving for love to be who we are. You know, when I depend on my understanding, lies run rampant in my brain. Things can pop up at any time in an attempt to slow my walk and can slow your walk in Christ. Many things. It only takes a little breeze, just somebody to say something before you're going, I did it again. I fell for it, and I became part of the conversation. I actually fell into an agreement with it. But that slows our walk with God. Loving God with our mind means renewing my mind daily. Renewing it so that I may think more of his thoughts instead of my own. This isn't just a message. This isn't just a sermon. This is information from our Lord, what he wants from us, what he expects from us. It should be what we desire because, again, we love him. So we should want to know his thoughts by reading the Bible daily. And then with study and repetition, some of his thoughts go into my brain and replace those old nasty lies. God's will and thoughts are good, pleasing, and perfect. I need as much of them as possible to fill and to renew my mind. Do you remember Romans chapter 12, verse 2? Did I give you them? Romans chapter 12, verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world. Separated. We are separated from this world in this way. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. See, it's more than saying, I love God and I'm separate from the world. It's what we do, as the scriptures tell us. It's who we become. When we become not like what other Christians, not measuring our spirituality based off of who does the most in your church. That tells us nothing. You know nothing of their heart. You know of their desire. You might know of what they like to do, or you don't know. You measure your spirituality by what the Word says, what God's Word says. We're having a problem with that. I have heard it more times than none that I do just as much as Sally Mae or whoever it is, that I think I'm fine. But it's not about that. It's about, are you renewing your mind? Are you loving God? Are you new in Christ? I can take a cue, and I guess you could too. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence, and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. So we'll replace the lies and negative thoughts, etc., with thoughts that are true, honest, pure, lovely, and virtuous. See, I can pray and ask God to put a hedge of protection around my mind and thoughts, and so can you. That's a good thing to pray as you start your day, as you wake up in the morning, clearing your mind, clearing your heart, making room that God fills your heart and your mind. All of us struggle in that area because we wake up with some issue. It starts off for a lot of people, or for some people, waking up late. And I'm not going to mention any names, Ricky. But if you're honest with yourself, you admit that a high percentage of your thoughts are entirely self-focused. But God's word, it gives you a new, much higher perspective. Daily Bible reading will fill your mind so full of good things that there isn't any room left for any kind of ridiculous lies, anything of this world. So renewing my mind in God's word is an important way of loving God. The last thing, your strength, with all your strength. Doing a study on my actions, doing a study on your actions. How do we move? Do we move with the strength of the Lord? Do we cop out? I just can't do it. I like to get rid of that word. In the Marine Corps, we didn't use that word I. Okay? We didn't use the word you either, because that was a sheep, right? But I becomes more self-serving. I like to, see, look, I'm already using the word now. I don't know if I can get out of this. But the Lord working through me directs my path and enables Him to do His will through me. Wow, I did make it through. Transformation. If there is no transformation, what is it? Stepping out on faith isn't just to be done at your house, isn't just done trying to find a preschool teacher, or trying to find a preacher, trying to find a Sunday school teacher, trying to find somebody on the baptismal committee, or whatever. Having faith and saying that I know somebody's going to step up and fill these positions, faith covers every area of our lives, every area through the church life. It's saying that, Lord, I'm going to do what you desire with the very words of these scriptures say. I'm going to do it, and I'm going to have faith and know that you're going to take care of my every need. Do you think that stops with you at home, or do you think that it might have to do with the very church that he loves? Faith. Faith. We enact it here. We don't enact it there. We're stuttering. We're like a flickering light. We decide where we enact faith and then where we got to take a hold, where we've got to grip it. So stepping out on faith and taking actions enables me to remember what I learned. And it also enables me to help other people, show other people how much I love God. God likes it when you and I are led by faith to act. Love by faith in everything that we do. In Bible study, we learn that worship isn't just singing. It is living by faith so that other people see our example. It is preventing my body and my actions. Presenting. It is presenting my body and my actions as a living and holy sacrifice to the God I love. Where is that? Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Presenting ourselves in that way. It's even doing things that are right and good, even when we don't see any kind of reward. Pleasing God should be our biggest and most wanted reward. A lot of times we don't see some kind of reward for others' actions, for our actions of faith, but we won't. Not all promises are meant to be fulfilled in the here and now that we want. Some will be fulfilled much later. That's what I'm building up. in a more huge, a more perfect way in the hereafter. Don't be fooled into the lie that your good deed will go unnoticed forever, because it's not true. God knows, God sees, God rewards. God loves all our good deeds and will bring something good out of all of them. So loving God with all your strength means stepping out in faith. It means stepping out of my comfort zone, out of your comfort zone. It means stepping out to help someone else. James 2:20 mentions that faith without works is dead. Faith without works isn't worth much at all. But faith with works can and will change a piece of the world for the better. We need to change gears in the way we think if we don't understand this type of love. We need to start thinking in the way, knowing that the reality is loving the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind and strength is simply a response. That is, he's telling us that is what we must do, but it is simply a response to the fact that he loved us first. The fact that he loved us first. A lot of things we've done in church for many years, and we've just followed routines, and we've done things that our parents have taught us, or just whatever it is. You might not have had the right motive or whatever, but today we need to understand that it needs to be a for sure. We need to know that we have a real relationship with Christ, that we truly believe that Jesus died on that cross for our sins. See, this very thing that we keep mentioning over and over again enacts a change in us. And that change is what we're, from that point on, is when we seek the love of God. Who is this Jesus that would die on the cross for our sins and then raise from the dead and give us eternal life with him? Who is this God? Reading the New Testament and watching him walk this earth, forgiving, healing, teaching, giving us the commands that he wants us to do. He reminds us as Christians, if you cannot be my disciple, I mean, if you can't love me like this, you cannot be my disciple. If you can't pick up your cross and follow me, you can't be my disciple. And I will tell you right now, in heaven, there is no one that is not a disciple. Everyone is a disciple for Christ that is in heaven and has been. So are you ready to pick up your cross and follow him? This isn't a fancy way to get anybody to come to the altar. This is a real, truthful way. You could be 80, you could be 75, 70, whatever age, and always thought that, wow, I thought I was saved. It's so important, and I keep bringing it back up because I've seen it happen over and over again with people that think, and they aren't. But this is your chance now. Do it at the pew. If you can do it there at the pew, you can do it. Come up here and share with me, and I'll pray with you. Whatever you choose to do, let's do that now. Also, it's an opportunity to come forward if you want to be part of something special at Blackwell Memorial. We would like you to come and be part of something special here as we continue to grow, to minister, reach needs of the people in the community, and share the gospel. What a great thing. Or you might just want to come to the altar just to share. You're hurting in some way. Your family members are hurting. You just need to pray for someone, or you need to pray for yourself, or you need prayer. These are all times you can do that during this special moment that we call invitation. But let's do that now, okay? Let's sing together. Please stand. Y'all may be seated if you will. So again, I introduce to you Brother Joe and Miss Robin Bangert. They've been coming to Bible study and now church. They're from the Edenton area, or live in the Edenton area. I'm not going to say from there. And they've been part of us now for a little bit, and it's exciting. What I want to do first is I want to give them their baptismal certificate, okay? So, and it has your date, the date on it. Help you remember if you're like me. Can't remember from one day to the next. But I talked to them for about 3 hours one day, and we did like a crash course. I know people are wondering how I've done things or whatever, but one of the things we need to understand as members of a church or potential members of the church is that we have a responsibility. We have a responsibility to the church. The church has a responsibility to each other. Brother Joe and Ms. Robin, we talked about that responsibility. We talked about serving. We talked about the responsibility of the church, and now their responsibility to those also in the church and new people. And they desire to be part of Blackwell Memorial Baptist Church. So right now, what I'd like to do is lift them up to say to everyone, for all those that will welcome Brother Joe and Robin into our fellowship, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, there isn't any. So it's good. Welcome. They're going to be up front here. We request that you, if you can, please come down and shake their hand and welcome into the fellowship. And we thank you so much for being part of the celebration. On another note, I wanted to tell everybody in the church that I thank each one of you for your heart. It was very much heartfelt sympathies and your words, cards, flowers for my mother's passing. It was it made it more bearable because of the family. We have a bigger family, right? And my mom did get a chance to understand what Blackwell was part of. We were sending her newsletters, and she was able to read it and understood it. And I'm still her baby boy, even though I'm not her youngest boy. And so she was happy to see what was going on and wished she could be here. She wanted to be here to be part of that, but obviously couldn't. She passed away Tuesday. We had the week and a half ago, she passed away on Tuesday, but it's drug out because she's going to be buried with my father in the military cemetery Tuesday. They are booked. You want to know why it's good to know Jesus? Every hour on the hour, they're burying somebody in that cemetery. It has taken a week and a half for there to be any availability. So they will be burying her Tuesday. So thank you again for everybody that has sent me a card and called me and told me in church and the classes, everything. A lot of individuals, so thank you so much. And what we're going to do right now is we're going to pray, and again, please come up and welcome them after the prayer, okay? Let's do that now. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the chance that we have in the ministry, Lord, to be excited and to share your word, the privilege we have to share your word and to share your love, Lord, and to worship together. And Lord, not to worship together in the way that we know it, but the way the scriptures share it, Lord. The fact that we can share and encourage each other and pray for each other, to love each other, have the same concerns. Lord, it just amazes me to see how awesome your love is, how the scriptures were, Lord, created out of your love for us, that we don't need to try to love any different than what the love you commanded us to do. Lord, to take care of each one as we leave here, Lord, get them back to their home safely. And Lord, also keep your hand on Brother Joe and Miss Robin. As they move forward in you, Lord, give us the know, Lord, the strength and the ability to be to them who we need to be as a church, and to them, to us. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.